Good morning, Acts family, and welcome to our virtual Sunday service. We're so grateful you joined us to lift God's name today, and we thank you for the continued support. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube and to follow us on social media at Acts Santa Monica to stay up to date on all things happening. And if you would like to give to our church, you could do so by going online to actsantamonica.org and by clicking on the donating tab. You can also give by mail and send it into P.O. Box 7217 in Santa Monica, California. We look forward to receiving your gifts. Now this week's verse is Ephesians 4:32, which says, "Be kind to one another, forgive and love one another just as I have forgiven and loved you." Friends, a support system is so important. You need people around you that you can rely on. And show people how to be there for you. Tell people you need them to be there for you, all while being there for them. And remember, here at Acts, we love you, and we would love to pray for you. So send in any prayer requests through our social media pages or through our website. Now let's get our hearts ready for Pastor Joe's word with some praise.
Good morning, Tech. We're so happy to be here once again with you. Thank God. Hallelujah. How many of you are sold out today? Well, I can tell you one thing. I am. I'm sold out for Jesus. Hallelujah. Hey, come on, choir.
I am sold out.
My mind.
My mind is made up.
Hey, I'm sold out.
I am sold out.
My mind.
My mind is made up.
Help us sing it this morning.
Who can separate us from the love of Jesus?
Not death,
not death,
nor life.
Nor life.
Jesus paid it.
Jesus paid the price. Now I'm free from sin. I am sold out.
Put your hands together right there. My mind is
made up. My mind's made up.
Hallelujah.
No room, no vacancies. I'm all.
Well, hello again, friends. You know, for those of you who are in my age group, you remember David Ruffin's song, don't you? Let me give you just a few words of it, what becomes of a brokenhearted. He says, as I walk this land with broken dreams, I have visions of many things, but happiness is just an illusion filled with sadness and confusion. What becomes of the brokenhearted who had love that's now departed? I know I've got to find some kind of peace of mind. Well, those words ring true to the Apostle Paul in this text I want to share with you today. Now, I once talked about anxiety in the heart causing depression. I want you to know that many people suffer from a broken heart. I was recently reading in Psychology Today an article, and this sentence kind of jumped off the page at me. A broken heart can cost much. The high price of a broken heart? Yes, you can die from heartbreak. In fact, even mild forms of the blues can put you at risk. What a statement that is. Did you know that heartache can cause you all kinds of physical aches as well? Emotional damage. Well, my passage today comes out of 2 Corinthians, and I've preached this passage before, perhaps not in this tone, but I have brought this to your attention probably more than once. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4 are the topic of the day. However, I want to read into your hearing verses 3 through 7 here. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our affliction, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as we share abundantly in Christ's sufferings, so through Christ we share abundantly in comfort also. If we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which you experience when you patiently endure the same sufferings that we suffer. Our hope for you is unshaken, for we know that as you share in our sufferings, you will also share in our comfort. So the question for us today is, who can mend a broken heart? You may know someone with a broken heart, and you really want to share with them how they can mend that brokenheartedness. Or maybe you've experienced a broken heart yourself, and you're struggling with trying to mend it. Well, I think there are a couple of things to look at. The first is, who can mend a broken heart? Who is the person of this consolation and comfort? Who can bring such comfort to us when we are miserably sore and sick, or even ashamed of life because of what we've gone through? In verse 3 of our text, he says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. God mends the brokenhearted. The word comfort is used in this text 10 times in verses 1 through 7. Consolation is used, which is the same word, by the way, in verses 5, 6, and 7. And it literally means to call to one side. So what is Paul saying to us? He's really telling us that we need to call someone to our side when we are experiencing brokenheartedness. Now, look, I'd like to be able to share with you that that's the only time this word is used, but that's not true. It's the same word that Jesus used in John 14 and 16 when he spoke of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the Paraclete. God's view of our broken heart is rather counterculture. It's different. He sees it differently than we see it. You know, when your heart is broken, you mostly want to be left alone. You want to isolate. You want to sulk a little bit in your own pity, your own misery, so to speak, right? You want to be left alone in that miserable state that you're in. You don't want anybody to ask you any questions or offer any advice to you. But God's solution for the brokenhearted is to be with someone. You see, that's what he means by this word paraclete. It's one that comes alongside of you. So God's idea to bring healing to your broken heart is that you have to have a relationship with someone that you can trust. So let me see if I can ask you who your paracletic relationship is with. I want you to think about that for a second and ask yourself some questions like this. Who do you feel safe with? Who do you trust enough to tell your ills to? That's the person that you're looking for here. Who do you trust to have your best interests at heart? That's the paraclitical relationship that the Lord wants you to have. What a joy it is to know that God stands at our side to help whenever we go through our troubles. The scripture says so. He's always at our side. And next week, I'm going to preach out of the book of Isaiah, chapter 54, somewhere in there. But let me reference a couple of passages in Isaiah for you today, just to prove the fact that God wants to be with you in the midst of your troubles. Isaiah 41 and 10 says, "Fear not, for I am with you." "Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." That's God speaking to his people, regardless of what one might be going through. And the people of God at that time were troubled and their heart was truly broken. But the Lord had come alongside them through the words of the prophet Isaiah to let them know that he was with them. And he further illustrated that in a rather dynamic way, because listen to what he says in Isaiah 43, verses 2 and 3, the A part of 3. He says, "When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you, for I am the Lord your God." Think about that. Ask yourself, why am I going through this all alone? Why am I going through what I'm going through, isolating from everybody else in the world? Not because I can fix it myself. You don't even think you can fix it. You don't think it's ever going to be fixed, as a matter of fact. Here, the Word of God says at the most tragic time in the life of the Israelites, he would walk through the water with them. He would walk through the fire with them. He's saying that he's always going to be with you at your side. So we should be interested in knowing that each member of the Trinity is a comforter. God the Father is certainly a comforter. It says it right there in our third verse of our text today. And the Son and the Holy Spirit in John 14 and 16, as he references him there. I mentioned that earlier. God is the God of all comfort. So just as he is the God of all grace, according to Peter, there is comfort and grace for every situation that we go through. God has more comfort and grace than you have misery in your life. That's what I'm really telling you. You need to come alongside the Lord the moment you start feeling that your heart is being broken, because he's there for you. Someone said he wants to catch you before you fall. Excuse me. So who can mend a broken heart? God himself. That's who mends a broken heart. He's the Holy One that wants to come alongside of you with all of his mercy, with all of his grace, with all of his power to bring healing to your life. So the second point to be made is that God's purpose in mending the broken heart is a little bit different. And this is what I meant earlier when I said it's counterculture. See, God's purpose in mending a broken heart is different than what you think it is, because your thought is that I'll be okay again. That's why he wants to heal my broken heart. He loves me and I'm going to be okay. And he wants me to be happy and okay. That's what you think. No, God wants you to actually go through the brokenhearted experience. See, his purpose in coming alongside of you is just simply for that reason. So we look at the root of consolation and comfort. We see it in verse 5 of 2 Corinthians chapter 1. He says, "For as we share abundantly in Christ's sufferings, so through Christ we share abundantly in comfort also." So you have to go through something in order to get something. Now, look, Paul had been oppressed with a great deal of anxiety concerning the reception of his first letter to the Corinthians. And he feared that they would reject him because of that. And he had all this anxiety built up in him. He couldn't hold it in any longer. So he wrote this second letter to them to explain this. You see, once the report had come back to him and it aroused this great gratitude in him that the people still loved him and they still were concerned about him. They had not rejected him, as a matter of fact. The Judaizers wanted him to feel that he had been rejected because they had been working against him, but that was not the truth about Paul's life. These people loved him. So with these feelings mingled his anxiety, and it brought it all to a fever pitch. He was so nervous and so concerned, and he wanted them to continue making a contribution to Judea, and he wanted them to rush and get it in because the people in the city needed the help. So the second letter bears the marks of the high tension of feeling, which finds expression in frequent personal allusions. You know, Paul constantly talked about his own suffering, especially about his afflictions. But this comfort that we receive from God is not simply for our personal relief. It is shared with us that we might be able to help others. That's what the Word of God says. 2 Corinthians 1 and 4 gives us the fruit of consolation and comfort. Listen to what he says. "Who comforts us in all our affliction." Watch this. Here comes the fruit. "So that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction." With what? With the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. So what does all of that mean? It means that God prepares us for what he is preparing for us. He gets us ready by allowing us to go through some terrible times. He's getting us ready to share with someone else that's going to be going through terrible times. That's why we hear parents often say to kids, "Honey, you don't understand yet. That's going to be okay." But try and tell a teenager it's going to be okay. They're just falling apart, or a preteen, they're falling apart. Life is not going to be okay. The worst possible thing has happened. There's a pimple that popped out on their forehead. I mean, they're about to die. They look like an ogre. They don't know what to do. Well, a parent knows that that's going to go away one day. Well, it's the same thing. Life is full of challenges, and most of the challenges that we fall apart about are just pimples in society, and they're going to go away. I dare use this coronavirus pandemic as an example, but it too will pass. It's not gone yet, but it too will pass. We fall apart about everything. But what I'm telling you is that God has allowed certain things to happen to you so that he can bring comfort to you. And as he strengthens you by bringing comfort to you, he wants you then to take the comfort that he's given you and go comfort someone else that really has a need in their life. So every experience is really not for us necessarily, it's for someone else. We cannot lead others where we have not been ourselves. We can't tell anybody it's going to be okay when it has not been okay for us. We love to tell people, "Oh, have greater faith and have more faith," but it's not always about the faith that you have. It's sometimes about the experience that God wants to give you in life. You wonder, you ask yourself, why would I go and do something as silly as that? Look at the pain it caused me and others also. Look, I just embarrassed my dad. I embarrassed my mom. Oh my God, look what I've done. But the fact of the matter is, God wants you to learn something from that. Because eventually God brings healing to how you feel about that. And he's only bringing that healing for one purpose only, because somebody else in your life is going to go through that experience, and you're going to be able to tell them, look, God brought me through my experience like that. Friend, that's what it's all about. That's how we connect all of this praise we've been talking about for the past couple of months. That's why we can praise the Lord through our troubles, because eventually he's going to bring comfort to our hearts. You know, God prepares us for exactly what he is preparing for us. God has something for you to do that's important, but it's necessary that you go through this rough patch in life in order to get there. You know, it suggests that we suffer for his sake and for his glory, that he suffers with us. We only go through it because he has been through it. Repeatedly, we see the sufferings of Christ, as Paul told us about his own personal trials. He mentions it in verse 5, and he mentions it again in chapter 4 of this same book, verses 10 through 11. And in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 10, Paul says that he would himself personally look forward to the fellowship of the sufferings of Christ. He wanted to go through everything Christ went through because he understood that he'd be able to comfort others as God comforted him. Paul went through the greatest of all troubles on that Damascus road when the Lord slapped him down off of his beast, made him blind, and sent him to Straight Street. God knows that Paul had trouble. Everywhere he turned, Paul was in one city where he got beaten and stoned and thrown out. Paul himself records that he was in the deep, in the ocean, and he was going to drown. And it was Paul in the midst of this that once they got on the land, he told all of them, be still. None of you will drown because God is with us. How could Paul say that? Because his experience with God was of such that he had the courage and he had the faith to believe that God would bring him through it. God had a purpose for sending Paul on this missionary journey. God had a purpose for sending Paul to Rome. Imprisoned. God had a purpose for whatever it was that you went through in your life that you're not happy about. God has a purpose for that. And in the midst of it, he's going to bring healing to your life. And why is he going to bring healing to your life? Because he wants you to be able to bring healing to someone else. So in 2 Corinthians, Paul praised God for the present blessings that he had, for what God was accomplishing in and through him. Friends, we have to ask ourselves often when we look at this text. I want to repeat for you this 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 4 one more time. Here's what he says, because this is where the fruit is. This is where the fruit is. We got the root of it. We must go through it. But here's the fruit, the why we must go through it. It is because God is going to allow you to be used to bring comfort to someone else. That's God's plan for us. So what's our learning outcome here? What do we get from this information? That I have to go through something so that God can use me to bring comfort to someone else, as he brought comfort to me when I was at my most miserable place in life, when I was abandoned and left to all of my own. God says, yes, that's it, you got it. So our learning outcome here is, if you have experienced a broken heart, you need to know that God is calling you to help someone else whose heart is broken. You just may not see that person yet. You may not know who that person is yet, but you should trust that God is going to use what you have experienced. That's why we go through these things, is so that God will use it to bless our lives. When he said that he would be in the fire with us, ask yourself about the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Did not the king look in the furnace and say, hey, there, we put three in there, but there's a fourth one in there in the midst with them? And they were dancing. God is going to always be in it with you. When the children of Israel got freed from Egypt, and they got ready to cross the Red Sea with Pharaoh chasing them at their back. Who parted the waters for them? Who allowed them to walk over on dry land? It was God himself. See, God will do these things for us. We think just because he loves us, he's doing it. No, he's teaching us that we have to be willing and able to encourage someone else that's going through a struggle or looking toward a bad time. That's the whole purpose of this. That's why God has allowed this. While you are in your brokenhearted state, you must understand that you're not in that state alone. But the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort is in your trial with you. He's navigating your life through the web of circumstances for your learning in order that you will be available for someone else who's headed down that same road. You just don't know who that is yet. God wants to encourage us and comfort. He wants us to not only receive comfort from him, but to give comfort to others. And in order for you to give comfort to others, you've got to be like that surgeon. When that doctor goes in to operate on somebody's heart, he's skilled at what he does. He's done it before. So we expect that he'll do a good job now. God wants you to be the same kind of Christian as that surgeon is. Someone that trusts him, that have been through the rough times of life, and he has brought you through, and you've given him credit for bringing you through. You didn't take the credit. God wants you to be able to share with someone else so they can go through. Because you know what happens when you're gone? They're going to share it with someone else. You know what's going to happen when they're gone? They're going to share it with someone else. It's a cycle. But it's what God, the cycle that God has us in. You may not have an immediate answer to your brokenheartedness. You don't know why, how. How'd you get there? You don't know. But God wants you to realize that he is in the water, or he's in the fire with you. Because he's going to make you better as he heals you and bring you through, and you're going to have a testimony. And that's what it's all about, friends. It's about your testimony. It's about you telling somebody else that's hurting that God has the power to bring healing and comfort to their lives. Do you know why God is in the fire with you? He's not in there just to save you, but to let you know that it's all right for you to get in the fire with somebody else, because you're trusting him. That's why God is in the fire with you. He let that happen to you so that you can tell somebody else, it's going to be okay. We're going to make it. Friends, if you want a relationship with God, that paraclitic relationship, that relationship with someone that's going to come alongside of you in the midst of your trials, if you're looking for comfort in your life, then you need a relationship with Jesus Christ. The scripture says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ died on the cross and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. You shall enter into a relationship with the Almighty God. Would you receive the Lord today? Would you ask him to come into your life just with that simple prayer? Friend, God loves you. He cares an awful lot about you. He has a plan for your life, and somewhere in the plan is trouble. Not because you necessarily did anything wrong, but because he wants to be there to bring you through your trouble so that you can give praise to him and receive comfort from him so that you can go and tell somebody else that the God that comforted you will comfort them with the same comfort that he comforted you with. God is looking for you. And you can say it this way, and I know it doesn't sound good. God is looking for you to get in some trouble. You know why? Because he wants to counsel you through your trouble, and he wants to comfort you as you come out of it. So trust the Lord, friends. God bless you.
You've been carrying them too long. But there is that it can. That it did it for me.
Can make you whole.
And I want you to know.
And it flows from the veins
of
Jesus.
We call him Jesus.
My Savior.
But he's our Savior.
My healer and redeemer.
He's a lover.
A lover.
The greatest love I've ever known.
So true.
Bless your name, Jesus.
It has power.
Power to heal.
To heal.
Every last sin.
All our sin.
Hey.
Disease.
Can't you hear him? He's calling.
So come to the throne.
For there at the throne.
Your healing is here.
Healing.
That can.
Forgiveness.
That can.
Another chance.
That.
Thank you, Jesus.
Can.
Make.
Make.
Make you whole.
You whole.
There's a bond
between you and me.
Bless your name.
It's here.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Your healing.
Thank you.
It's here.
Your forgiveness.
Forgiveness.
No matter what you've done, no matter how long you've done.
Forgiveness. It's here.
And your salvation.
Salvation.
Oh.
It's here.
You're completely saved.
Salvation.
Yes.
It's here. Acceptance.
Acceptance.
Come as you are, without pretense.
Acceptance.
No need for shame.
Yes,
his grace will admit it. Yes, it is.
Deliverance.
Oh, yeah.
And his presence.
His
right hand extended. Pleasures evermore.
His
presence is the fullness of joy.
Mercy.
Thank you.
It's here.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. His mercy.
Oh, yeah.
It's here.
Come on,
His
right
power.
Now.
His power.
And
here.
I know it is, yeah.
His power. It's here.
Yeah.
Joy. It's here.
Unspeakable joy.
Joy. It's here.
I want to thank you for your joy.
Thank you,
Jesus.